Welcome to our YouTube channel. God bless you. You are about to listen to a message from the Church of the Almighty God in the lips of a pastor. The blessings await you as you listen and pray along. For any inquiry, partnership, and prayers, please check our YouTube page for contacts as you click the select icon. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell to be notified on upcoming videos. And do not forget to share. God bless you.
Shall we please pray? The Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will come before you because you are the mighty God. We pray, Lord, as we look at your word today, you will bless the listeners. You will bless the preacher. You will bless the teacher. Oh, Lord, I pray that your word will touch us today. We pray, Lord, that you open our eyes to your word. You give us insight into your word. You give us understanding. Thank you, Lord, because I know that you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen, amen, and amen. Today, the Lord will be speaking to us from the systematic study of Ephesians 3:108 in the series Learning and Leaning on the Leader's Life, Part 47. But before we go any further on that, let's take a quick recap of what the Lord told us last week. Last week, the Lord spoke to us from three perspectives. Perspective number one, the vivid description of ambassadorial duty. Perspective number two, the vociferous demand of ambassadorial designation. Perspective number three, the vibrant devotion of ambassadorial dynamo. The Lord spoke to us from the vivid description of ambassadorial duty from Ephesians chapter 6, verse 20a, for which I am an ambassador in bonds. The Lord spoke to us from there, and we're able to understand that the ambassador is controlled by the statutory rules of his or her office, that the ambassador is tied to the interests of the country in representation, that the ambassador severally weighs in on executing the objectives of the country in representation. We're also told that the ambassador is restricted to the demands of the country in representation. We are told that the ambassador is energized by the love for his or her country. We are told that he esteems or she esteems or prioritizes the expectation of his or her country than personal ambition. We are told that the ambassador is very definite in his or her discharge of duties. We are told that he or she is aware of the fact that it's just one person in the number of ambassadors across the globe. And then we were also told last week about the vociferous demand of ambassadorial designation. We're told that from Ephesians 6, verse 20b, that therein I may speak boldly. That we're told about the specific features of ambassadors. Number one, the voidness of timidity. Number two, the demonstration of confidence. Number three, that they vocalize the lofty aims of the country in representation. Then number four, they publicly announce his strong duty stance. They were also told, number five, they overshadow any opposing voices against the position of the country in representation. We're told, number six, that steps must be taken to establish the voice of God in his or diplomatic offices, no matter the characteristic social backgrounds. In other words, number seven, personal voices must be hushed by the divine voice, irrespective of the religious beliefs of the country in representation. We're told about perspective number three, the vibrant devotion of ambassadorial dynamo. Ephesians 6 verse 20c, as I ought to speak. We're told about the pattern of the Christian's speeches. Number one, we do not speak to please men only at the expense of God's pleasure. No, rather, we please the Almighty God always. We do not speak to please ourselves against God's expectations. Rather, we displease ourselves to please the Almighty God. Number three, we do not speak to support evil and its inclinations around us. Rather, we speak against all forms of uncleanness. We do not speak to support sins and sinful habits. Rather, we act against sinful practices. We do not speak to partner with evil companionship. Rather, we are influenced. Well, we influence our listeners in the most positive ways. We do not speak to deny our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Rather, our lives are centered on the Redeemer, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We do not speak to socialize to the spiritual detriment of our listeners. Rather, we socialize to win other people to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We do not speak to ourselves. Rather, we live not for ourselves only. We do not speak to activate revengeful tendencies. Rather, we challenge one another to greater works and not to be carrying and hate. We do not speak to destroy the existing righteousness and holiness in the lives of our listeners. Rather, we spur other people on to live righteously. We do not speak to underrate and weaken the strengths or abilities of our listeners. Rather, we speak to strengthen the innate abilities of our listeners. We do not speak to weaken the faith in other people. We help build other people's faith in the Almighty God through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We do not inject by attracting evil spirits of jealousy and envy in our listeners. We possess the Holy Ghost, so we should transmit holiness to our listeners. We do not speak to suggest hate in other people. We suggest the golden option of love to our listeners. The Lord was indeed gracious to us last week, and His grace is still here for us today. And we'll be looking at systematic study of Ephesians study 108 from Ephesians 6 verse 21. But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do. Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things. Ephesians 6 verse 21, I read again. But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do. Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things. The responsibility of the minister. He updated the church at Ephesus how he was doing through his letters. It is a responsibility in today's church that the ministers or the leaders in any organization to be able to update his or her followership, his or her learners about his or her affairs. You can see again Ephesians 6 verse 21, but that he may also know my affairs and how I do. Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things. Even in the societal framework, in the larger society, in the countries or nations where we are, where we live or where we come from, even the leadership of the entire country can decide to tell the people about his affairs and how he or she is doing. Look at that verse again, Ephesians 6 verse 21, but that he also may know my affairs and how I do. Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things, which means between the presidents, between the head, between the leadership and the learners, there's somebody there. There's a co-minister. There's an associate person that is helping to disseminate or carry out that function. That if it's not them, person, Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things. If the leadership of the country is not disposed to tell the people about their situation, about the president's situation, about the nation's leadership, about the governor's situation, about whatever it is, about the captains of industry, it's not able to tell the people directly, there's someone there like Tychicus. A beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord shall make known to you all things, even in the church. If the pastor is not disposed to tell the people, the learners, or the followers about his affairs, he should be able to have Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, shall make known to you all things. The Lord wishes to speak to us today in three dimensions. Dimension number one, caring for affectionate leaders. Dimension number two, caring for aiding leaders. And dimension number three, concerns from affirmative leaders. You look at dimension number one, caring for affectionate leaders. It's not just leaders, but affectionate leaders. The leaders that are helpful. The leaders are indeed true leaders. And then point number two, caring for aiding leaders. It's not just the affectionate leaders. It's not just the head or the leading team. It is that this head has aides. It has people that work, associate with him or her, then they also need to be cared for. It's not just caring for the affectionate leaders. It's not just caring for the head of the leading team. It's not just caring for the affectionate leader. It is also caring for the aiding leaders. And dimension number three, concerns from affirmative leaders. There are concerns. Concerns from the affectionate leaders, concerns from the aiding leaders, and we'll be exploring that today. Dimension number one, caring for affectionate leaders. Ephesians 6 verse 21a. But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do. We see that Apostle Paul's life was characterized by sacrifices and threats. At one time, his life was threatened, either by natural disaster or by some people. Now, he was given to the work of the Almighty God. He was surely given to that work. He was given to the work of the ministry. He preferred the work to his life. He lived a life of sacrifice. He died to himself. He died to himself, a want of having the glory that will be given to him by heaven, against the pleasures of life and the pleasings of life. Now, this was characteristic of Apostle Paul. And he was the one asking the people that, look at it there, but that he also may know my face and how I do. He was pouring up in the people that they need to know about his affairs and how he was doing. It means that he wanted love from the people. He wanted to update the people of his love, of his spiritual work, of his missionary work. That was the situation. And then we need to look at the qualifications of worldly leadership for the care of the leaners. Why would he be qualified to tell the people, to update the people and make such statement, but that he also may know my affairs? Why would the people want to know about his affairs? Why would the people want to care about him? Why would he do that? Why would they want to feel the pulse of the people about his affairs and how he was faring and how he was doing? So we need to look at the qualifications of worldly leadership for the care of the learner, because not every leader may be worthy to attract the attention or the care of the learner. We need to look at that now, because followers of learners are admonished to care about the affairs of their leaders. Apostle Paul was sensitive to the care of his own listeners. He prayed for it. He knew as a memoir, felicitations and helps from genuine listeners or followers were necessary for the good of his ministry. He knew that the Almighty God had positioned people like minds to give the needed assistance of love and prayers in order to have God's word sealed across the globe. Now, we should take deliberate steps to care for our leaders by asking about their welfare. We should be concerned about their spiritual state. And then we should be passionate about their social and physical well-being. This is a part of our servitude to the Almighty God, because if we care for our leaders, or those the Almighty God is using to bless us, our needs will be taken care of also. Now, the Bible makes it very clear that it's not all invitations for support that should grip our attention. For us to be qualified to request, number one. For us to be qualified to accept, number two. For us to be qualified to use the offerings of the people, the offerings of love, the offerings of prayers. For us to be qualified to do that in propagating the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, we must fall within the qualification bracket. Number one, self-denying life. From 1 Corinthians 15, verse 31, it reads, I protest by your rejoicing, which I have in Christ Jesus, our Lord, I die daily. If we are not dying daily, we are not worthy of the people. If we are not dying daily, we are not worthy of the love and the prayers of the people. We must die daily. Apostle Paul died daily. He suffered himself to resist the temptations and trials from within and without the church at Ephesus. What? He was there for the missionary work. The biblical technique for communicating with the Ephesians through letters was astounding. He died daily. He died to himself daily. Do we die daily and yet we crave after the prayers, after the love, after the offerings of the people? And then point number two, there has to be constant victories over the beast. You look at 1 Corinthians 15, verse 32. If after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage yet it me? If the dead rise not, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. He fought the beast at Ephesus. He fought the beast on the behalf of the Ephesians. He fought the beast. Do we fight the beast in the lives of the people that we're ministering to? Do we fight the beast in the lives of the people that we're administering something to or services to? Do we fight the beast? Because Apostle Paul fought the beast of Ephesus in order to establish the word of God there. The beasts presented themselves in this variance. Number one, what does it mean that Apostle Paul fought the beasts at Ephesus? What does it mean? The beasts of Ephesus presented themselves in this form. Number one, calls to compromise the holy standards of God's word to please some insincere brethren. They were there in the church, insincere brethren. The calls to Apostle Paul to lower the standard. No, he fought the beast. He stood for the standard of the word of God. Number two, social influence to drift from his calling to serve the Almighty God. There was social influence around the church, but he never drifted. Number three, hypocrisy in the church in captivity of Satan, whose objective is to block the sound teachings of God's word from reaching the Ephesians. You were there hijacking the word of God, trying to deprive the people from the word of God. Apostle 4 fought the beast. He fought the beast. And then number 4, the prince of the power, the heir of Ephesus, which controlled his socio-economic activities and governance. There at Ephesus, the governance was there. The socio-economic activities, the prince of the air controlling it, fought the work of Apostle Paul in the church at Ephesus. Yet he fought the beast and he had victory over the beast. And then number 5, the forces of darkness in Ephesus did not want the demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost. Yet Apostle Paul fought the beast. Number 6, the forces of darkness that was practically fighting the boldness and utterance of the message of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in his heart and mouth. They fought it. They wanted to remove the boldness out of his heart and the utterance out of his lips, but they fought the beast. They sought for the prayers of the brethren. They fought the beast, established the word there, they preached the word of God there. And then number 7, the false brethren who were outright demoniacs in the church, playing the scripts of the devil. The first brethren were there. They said they were sisters. They said they were brethren. But they were possessed of the works of darkness and trying to walk with Paul the apostle. Paul the apostle fought the beast at Ephesus. But the question to you and I, do we overcome the barriers or the specific beasts around us that are bent on having us to please the Almighty God with our words and actions? That's the point. Do we overcome them when they suggest or trying to steer our words and action against the pleasing of Almighty God? Are we able to overcome or fight the beast to stand still? Are we immoral people in the gaze of the ministerial offices? Have we been able to conquer the evil presence of selfishness in our own lives? And we're administering to the people. We have been able to fight the beast in our organization, the beast in our society, the beast in our district, the beast in our community, the beast in our lives, the beast in our family. If you're not able to fight the beast, then there cannot be victory. We need to stand and say, Lord, we'll fight the beast here ruling this home. We'll fight the beast here ruling this family. We'll fight the beast ruling this place, ruling this country, and ruling this community. And number 3, the speechless communication. Because for a leader to be qualified to receive concerns, to know his or her affairs from the learners or followers, then this leader must be spotless in communication. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33, be not deceived, evil communications corrupt good manners. Apostle Paul did not falter to the praise of the enemies of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. He distinctively made the difference of what God expects of the Christian. He set himself out. He was not among the pack. He was a distinctive Christian. But when last did some unbelievers around us say, who are you and what is informing your kind words? That is to say, how are you behaving this way? What is it that is moving you or the force behind you in your life that is making us to behave this way? When last did you hear that from the unbelievers around us? Because you see, evil communication, communal good manners, and then number 4, qualification of the leadership such that we attract the concerns of our listeners over our affairs, transparent purity and holiness. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 34, awake to righteousness and sin not. For some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. Apostle Paul's life was truly Christ-centered. It was full of the knowledge of God and it lived up to it. It didn't say the people are born again over there and so all they do now is acceptable because they are born again. All they say is acceptable because they are born again. All they write is acceptable because they are born again. No, that you are born again today doesn't mean that you'll be born again tomorrow. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 35, I read again, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have the knowledge of God, and I speak this to your shame, that the knowledge of God in our life will be a transforming knowledge. It will be a testifying knowledge that others will see and say, wonderful. This must be a disciple of Christ. This must be a Christian. When last did an unrepentant sinner ask us to experience the grace of salvation that are evidential in our lives? When last were we told that, and our prayer point is that we will pray that we will be qualified to be recipients of the sacrificial gift of our followers and learners. Number 2, that we'll pray that we'll keep upholding the holy standards of heaven that are required of us. Let's look at dimension number 2 now, caring for aiding leaders. In Ephesians 6, verse 21b, how I do, Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord. We have to have how I do to this part so that we explain better. Now you see here, it was not just asking the people or trying to tell the people that you need to know about my affairs or how I do. But he was saying that Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, he was going to transmit that to you. He was going to tell you about that. And the way you see the mood of Paul the Apostle, the way he said it, it's not just to transmit to the people, informed, updated people about his affairs, about his spiritual state, about his social physical state. It was not just talking about himself. It was talking about even the minister he sent to Ephesus. It was talking about Tychicus too. That we need to also know the affairs of Tychicus. Tychicus will relate my issues to you, but it's also needful that you know the physical social state of Tychicus, because he is a beloved brother. He is a faithful minister in the Lord. Apostle Paul was the head of the missionary work. He had in his hand, it was not only bothered about himself alone. He was concerned for his associates in ministry. He had a helping hand in ministry to be fond of by the same people he was urging assistance of love and prayers from. Every leader has an aide. Every leader has an associate. Leadership is in straighter the head and helpers. You see, in leadership, you see the hierarchy of leadership, you have the head and then you have the helpers. The helpers are diversified. It is biblical injunction for the head and the helpers to be catered for from the same resources. Apostle Paul did not say that he should be offered some care in higher proportions to his associates. He mentioned the issue of his affairs first though and immediately, and that of his associate Tychicus, whom he called a faithful brother. Apostle Paul gathered his followership at Ephesus, whom the Almighty God has granted through his ministry and association with Tychicus, to pay attention to their affairs. This brings us to the mind that mutuality of successful ministerial work is based on the collaborative work of the preacher and the brethren, who should contribute to the progress of God's work in the hands of one another. In our hands, very critical, because internal rewards will be given not just to the heads or associates of missionaries, but also to the facilitators. And our prayer point is that we'll pray that we have the resources to share with our associate leaders. And two, that we'll pray that we'll become worthy associate leaders ourselves. Second green now will be taken from Philippians 1 verse 27. Only let your conversation be as it becoming the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Apostle Paul was so concerned about the affairs of the people, and he also loved the issue of the people being aware of the developments with him about his own affairs. That leads us to the dimension number three, concerns from affirmative leaders. These leaders are affirmed. Apostle Paul was an affirmative leader. He was affirmed by the Holy Spirit. Tychicus was an affirmative, faithful minister of God. He was affirmed by the Holy Spirit through Paul the Apostle. And then we look at Ephesians 6 verse 21c, shall make known to you all things. Because as genuine brethren care about the affairs of the ministers in turn are to respond by heightening the teachings of the listeners from the whole word of God, the whole word of righteousness that guarantees the eternity in heaven. Look at that verse again, Ephesians 6 verse 21c, it says, shall make known to you all things. We'll be looking at the responsibilities of leaders to learners. What are the responsibilities of leaders to learners? Number one, teaching the whole counsel of the word of God. Teaching the whole word of God. Number two, tracking the incorruptible seeds of the word of God in the lives of their listeners. It's not just enough to teach. It's not just enough to preach the word. It's to track. It's to see the development of the incorruptible seed that came out of their mouth, so that the people will grow and be nurtured in the world. And number three, striving to impart the gracious word of the Almighty God on their listeners. Sometimes there's always a blockage, an apparent blockage. The preacher, the teacher, don't want to offend the listeners, but we should take that aside, because this word in itself is transcendent. So we must try to impart the gracious word of the Almighty God through eternity. And for those that will listen and obey all through eternity, they'll be grateful to God for your life. But if you want to adulterate the word, you want to corner the world, you want to remove what will offend the people, what will touch the people to please them, and then they go along that line and they miss heaven. All eternity, they will have you to be blamed. And point number four, thoughtful in handling the affairs of their listeners. All their learners, we should be thoughtful as leaders, we should be thoughtful in handling their affairs. And number five, telling the learners or followers about their affairs, their testimonies, their challenges, their victories and their visions. It's very, very important that the leaders should be able to transmit their challenges, their testimonies, their victories and visions to their learners. It's very critical. And then we look at the prayer points. Number one, pray that we do not remove the ancient landmarks of the word of the Almighty God in our leadership roles over our learners or followers. Prayer point number two, pray that we make eternity in heaven after this life's journey. And the Lord has blessed us today. And it's very critical that we will not be able to make this eternity with all this evil in our life. Proverbs 6 verse 16, it says, "These things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him." Proverbs 6 verse 17, "A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood." Proverbs chapter 6 verse 18, "And heart that deviseth wicked imagination, feet that be swift in running to mischief." Proverbs chapter 6 verse 19, "A false witness that speaketh lies, and that sweats discord among the brethren." Revelation 21 verse 8, "But the fearful and the unbelieving and abominable and the monstrous and warmongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which punish with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." And do not forget that in Revelation 20 verse 11, "And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them." In Revelation 20 verse 12, "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged after those things which were written in the books according to their works." Revelation 20 verse 13, "And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered all the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works." Revelation 20 verse 14, "And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, this is the second death." Revelation 20 verse 15, "And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into fire." The Lord is saying that we need to repent of our sins now, and you need to talk to him and say, "Lord, have mercy upon me." So let's announce your point number one, Ephesians 6 verse 21a, "But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do." Ask of the affairs of your leaders. They need to be well and good to play their respective leadership roles. It's very critical that we do that. Celestial action point number two. "How I do." Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord. Ephesians 6 verse 21b. "The art of greetings includes caring or knowing the state of the well-being of the personality involved." Celestial action point number three. "And shall make known to you all things." Ephesians 6 verse 21c. "As leaders, we should transmit the complete life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to our learners or listeners." Celestial action point number four. "Be the leader heaven can count on." Celestial action point number five. "Be the learner or follower heaven can trust." And the question to you and I: do you ever care about the affairs of your leaders and their associates? Rise up wherever you are right now. Say, "Lord, I will care about my leaders. I will care about my associate leaders. I will care about them. I will pray for them. I will pray for them. I will show them love. I will transmit love to them. I will pray on their behalf. I'll pray for the success of their ministries and whatever thing I need to facilitate in their ministry that will make the progress of the word of God great in this world. Lord, I will contribute my portion." Talk to the Lord now. "Lord, I may not be a leader, may not be an associate leader. Oh Lord, maybe I'm a follower, maybe I'm a learner. Lord, I will contribute to the success, to the spiritual success, to the physical, social success of my leader and the associate leader. Lord, I will contribute so that heaven will count on you." Talk to the Lord now. And if you're a leader and you are caring about the affairs of the people, the Lord will raise people to care about your affairs too. And they will care about your affairs. And you'll be well and good to do the work of the living God. And the Lord will help you. The Lord will help us in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for the people. Touch them wherever they are, so that we can care for one another, so your work will prosper in the world, in Jesus' name. And if you have not given your life to Christ, and you say after me right now, "Lord, I come before you. Lord, have mercy upon my soul. And I promise you, Lord, I won't go back to sin anymore. Give me the power of sonship or daughtership in the mighty name of Jesus." And if I pray that prayer sincerely, the grace of God will touch you right now. I pray for the individuals that have prayed that prayer sincerely. I pray, "Lord, the power of sonship and daughtership you give unto them, empower them, embolden them to live for you from now henceforth in Jesus' name." Thank you, Lord, because I know that you have answered. Touch the people. Bless the people, that the people will care about the affairs of their leaders, not castigating them. They'll care about their associate leader, not castigating them. We'll pray, oh Lord, the leaders themselves will care about the affairs of their learners and followers, not castigating them. I pray your work will progress even in the torrents of life in Jesus' mighty name. name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. God bless you.
Thanks for listening to the message. The blessings await you as you obey and pray along. For any inquiry, partnership, and prayers, please check our YouTube page for contact as you click on the select icon. Please like, subscribe, and click the bell to be notified on upcoming videos. And do not forget to share. God bless you.